sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, sing it out. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place.
Amen. Aren't you thankful for what he's done for you? Amen. Amen. He is the King above all kings. Amen. And we're so grateful that he is. And we get to, you know, listen to that little video. Got to see God's word, his Bible. So we're getting into his word this morning. We're continuing on in Acts 24. You know, this is where Paul gets brought before Felix the governor. And you get to hear in this passage here, we're reading of his response to the accusations. So we're starting in verse 10, going through verses 23, and you can follow along in your Bibles there. Also, we'll be going up to 23, so you can also follow on the screen. Here we go, starting in verse 10. When the governor had nodded for him to speak, Paul responded, Knowing that for many years you have been a judge to this nation, I cheerfully make my defense. Since you can take note of the fact that no more than 12 days ago, I went up to Jerusalem to worship, neither in the temple, nor in the synagogues, nor in the city itself, did they find me carrying a discussion with anyone or causing a riot. Nor can they prove to you the charges of which they now accuse me. But this I admit to you, that according to the way, which they call a sect, I do serve the God of our fathers, believing everything that is in accordance with the law and that is written in the prophets, having a hope in God, which these men cherish themselves, that there shall certainly be a resurrection of both the righteous and the wicked. In view of this, I also do my best to maintain always a blameless conscience, both before God and before men. Now, after several years, I came to bring alms to my nation and to present offerings, in which they found me occupied in the temple, having been purified without any crowd or uproar. But there were some of the Jews from Asia who ought to have been present before you and to make accusation if they should have anything against me. Or else let these men themselves tell what misdeed they found when I stood before the council, other than for this one statement which I shouted out while standing among them, for the resurrection of the dead, I am on trial before you today. But Felix, having a more exact knowledge about the way, put them off, saying, when Lysias the commander comes down, I will decide your case. Then he gave orders to the centurion for him to be kept in custody and yet have some freedom, and not to prevent any of his friends from ministering to him. May God bless the reading of his word.
Shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Yes, almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
King. Oh, you that in you, God, we have victory. Lord, your name is worthy to be praised. That's why we're here this morning. We're here to praise your name. God, that you are our hope. God, we cling to you. We look to you. From our hearts, I pray that we worship you. Take in your word, let it take root, and continue to soften our hearts to your voice, your word, your movement, your spirit in our lives. So God, we pray all this. Thank you for hearing us and answering our prayers. In Jesus' name, amen.
Seated, we're going to invite the kids 0 to 4 behind me, and from kindergarten on up through 5th grade down the hallway. So thank the praise team for their ministry this morning. Amen. So, this has been a challenging morning because of not only if I've been under the weather the last few days, but also the came in the screens and the computer had a little spat and they weren't speaking to each other. and I think that became operational 10 minutes before the first service. So you better be thankful, you, particularly for that new song, Hope Has a Name, that you had the words for it. So thankful to the Lord. Amen. This morning, as we continue to work our way through the book of Acts, that incredible journey, we are in Acts chapter 24, and because it's pretty straightforward in narrative, I want to focus on the real heart and soul of what Paul's argument really was in Acts 24. So today, I want us to focus in on what I call the zonal impact of the resurrection. Right? But before we begin to take that apart this morning, let me give you some quick background. Okay, so Paul now has finished his third missionary journey, and he wanted to get back to Jerusalem before Pentecost. It is 58 AD. This is about 25 years since the death, the burial, and resurrection of the Lord. The first missionary journey was launched around 47, 48, just about 15 years after the resurrection. And now the end of that third missionary journey is 10 years later. It's 58 AD. And so he goes to Jerusalem, but he is arrested in Jerusalem on some trumped up charges. And while he is in Roman custody, as we saw the last few weeks in Acts chapter 23, that there was a plot that was hatched to kill him while he was in Jerusalem, even under custody. So when the Roman commander, Claudius, became aware of it, he got Paul and with about almost 500 Roman soldiers with him and took him to the Roman headquarters in Judea, which was Caesarea. And so in chapter 23, we read that the soldiers in verse 31, in accordance with their orders, took Paul and brought him by night to Antipatris. And the next day, leaving the horsemen to go on with him, they returned to their barracks. And when these had come to Caesarea. So the picture here is Jerusalem is going to be, get this operational here, all right? There's Jerusalem, and they're going to be making their way to Caesarea. And the midpoint was a place called Antipatris, which was right near Jaffa or modern-day Tel Aviv. You can actually still see the remains of the fortress of Antipatris to this day. And Why was this such a strategic location for the Roman military? Because one, it was midpoint between their governing place of Caesarea and Jerusalem. And then secondly, because all the commerce really from three major continents would emerge along this plain area. And when it gets to Antipatris, you couldn't just simply go around. It all narrowed to a span of about 600 meters, and it forced those coming and going from Egypt into Europe or Asia. It forced a strategic place of passage. And so therefore, Herod the Great built the fortress there and named it after his father, Antipatris. And so then Rome, in taxation issues, took it over. But it was a great stopping point. If you were to go by horse from Jerusalem to Caesarea, it would be about a 24-hour journey. And so 12 hours in would get you to Antipatris. So you could see the strategic location of it. And I just think it's so cool that when you look at Scripture, the names, the places, all you can see them today. They have historical origin. Unlike Greek mythology, which you can read about, but you're not going to find the locations, you're not going to find the people. But Felix, for instance, Paul says, as he speaks in chapter 24, in verse 10, he says, when the governor had nodded for him to speak, Paul responded, knowing that for many years you have been a judge to this nation. Felix had been a judge for 6 years. He became the governor of Judea, just like Pontius the Pilate in the time of our Lord and Savior was the governor. So Felix became governor in 52. It's now in 58 AD. And he's going to remain governor for two more years. And in 60 AD, he's taken over by Festus. And that's going to be coming in chapter 25. And you know, just down the line, you can see the places, you can touch them, you can know the history of them. I just think it's so cool, the exactness of God's word. But I want you to notice that when Paul is giving his defense before the governor, he focuses on one issue and one issue alone. We find it here in verse 21 of chapter 24, where he says, other than for this one statement, in other words, why am I here? Other than for this one statement, which I shouted out while standing among them, for the resurrection of the dead, I am on trial before you today. That phrase, other than, can actually be translated in the Greek, what else then? In other words, what Paul is wanting to communicate, and it's a good lesson for us, is, you know what? Guys, we really have a lot in common. There's only one issue at stake. Yeah, I know you've got a bunch of trumped up causes for why you arrested me, like I was violating the temple and all that, but why aren't they here? It's because they were just trumped up charges. You know it and I know it. The reality is we have a lot in common, all right? We have the same law. We have the same prophets. We have the same forefathers. We have the same scripture. We have the same love for the temple. I was at the temple doing what every other good Jew would do. I am at the temple fulfilling the law's requirements. You know it and I know it. In fact, I was coming to give alms to my people because of the famine that had been in the land. I was caring for the nation, providing for the nation. I was being what a good Jew ought to be. The reality is, come on, guys, there's only one issue that divides us. I believe in the resurrection of the dead. I believe that Jesus of Nazareth died and rose again, and that's what this is all about. And I really deeply appreciate how Paul brings out what is the heart of the issue. And I believe that it would do us all well to understand that's how we boil down what we believe and why we believe. It's all about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The resurrection is the key that unlocks all our beliefs in who God is, how we can know Him, what God has done, what God has provided for sinful man, all of our beliefs, our issues of eternity and forgiveness of sin. It is all wrapped up in one historic event, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Sadly, I don't think that many Christians grasp the ultimate significance of the resurrection, just how the resurrection changes everything. It is the great eternal paradigm shift for faith and for practice. If you don't believe that the resurrection is the issue, it's the heart of the issue, then just read the book of Acts, dear friend. In fact, at every major event in the book of Acts, the resurrection is front and center. At every major happening in the book of Acts, for every major purpose for why things are done in the book of Acts, it is always the resurrection. In fact, from the very get-go in Acts chapter 2, they are wanting to know, what is this thing Pentecost? What is happening here? And why is the Spirit of God being unleashed here today at Pentecost? Give us an explanation. And Peter began to preach in Acts 2. And what was his explanation for the Spirit of God's outpouring among the people? It was the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And in Acts chapter 3, when they healed the lame man, born lame at the temple, begging alms day in and day out for almost 40 years of his life, you've gone to the temple and you've seen this lame man begging for alms, and now you see him leaping about. And they asked Peter, give us an explanation for what you just did then. And his explanation in Acts 3 is the resurrection is that which brings about this healing of this man today. In Acts 4, when they called him to account for explaining this miracle that was done at the temple, his answer is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so much so that in verse 12, he then says, and let me tell you, there is no other name in heaven and on earth that man might call upon to be saved. That's the power of the resurrection, dear friend. Excuse me. And in Acts chapter 5, when he is appearing before the council again, the same thing. The transformation of Paul on the Damascus Road is all about his encounter with whom? It is the encounter with the risen Lord, right? In Acts chapter 9. As they go now to minister to the Gentiles, offering them the hope of salvation. What's the basis of that? Acts 10, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. When they begin their first missionary journey, being launched to the world to tell the good news, what's the basis of their message? Acts 13, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. In Acts chapter 17, with the second missionary journey. And now here, when Paul is being arrested in Acts 23, before the Sanhedrin, he gives the explanation. It's the resurrection, dear friend. When he is standing before the Roman authorities here in Acts 24, he is letting it known. You know why I'm here? It is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's the power of the resurrection. It's not just something we celebrate at Easter and tuck away to the next year till we bring out our Easter hats and bonnets again, right? It is what is at the heart and the soul of every child of God, every moment of every day, and will be forever and ever. And so I want to offer you three zonal impacts that the resurrection should have in your life. Why is it so front and center with everything about the child of God? It is because, number one, Paul understood it is the ground of all assurance for your faith and for your practice. Isn't it interesting that in Hebrews chapter 10, the writer of Hebrews shares with us in verse 21, he says, we now have a great high priest who's ever interceding for us, who sits at the right hand of the Father. And then he follows that up with an amazing verse in verse 22. He says, therefore, let us draw near with a sincere heart. Now, draw near to what? He's speaking about drawing near the throne of God. And he has the audacity to say, we can draw near to the throne of God with full assurance of faith. Did you ever think that you could come before the actual throne of the holy, eternal God of this universe and do so with a sense of full assurance of faith? Not being, you know, oh my, you know, I'm afraid of every little step I take. God says, I want you to come before me with a full assurance of faith. Why? Because of the great high priest you have who has gone before you. So you see, God wants you and I to have a full assurance about when we meet him, when we encounter him, that we can even come before him right now in a full assurance of faith that I can come before God. I can call upon God in my need and in my crisis and in my hurt and in my fear and in my struggle. I can come before him. Why? Because of the resurrection. I have a full assurance that this one who has resurrected is my great high priest, whoever intercedes for me and stands at the right hand of the Father. You see, the resurrection is I think of it as peeling back the onion. You know, in each of our lives, we all need to kind of stop and at from time to time and kind of review what is our assurance, right? What is our confidence? What is our assurance? And as we do that, as we think about what gives us a confidence, you know, in difficult times and in heartbreaking times in our life and frustrating times in our life, what's going to give us confidence about being able to come before the throne of God? For me, I peel back that onion at least once a year, and I stop and I think about the fact that, okay, Jesus Christ resurrected from the dead, and we've preached on that a ton of times. There is more historical fact noting that Jesus resurrected from the dead than that Napoleon fought at Waterloo. If you don't believe me, I've got a ton of books. I'll give you plenty of reading to do, or you can look at one of the tapes. All right. But if Jesus resurrected from the dead, then that means just in sheer logic, you just bang, bang, bang. That means what he says about himself must be true. What did he say about himself? He said he was God. Before Abraham was, I am. And if Jesus Christ has resurrected from the dead, it verifies, that's what Romans chapter 1 says, it proves who he is. And so who is he? Well, what did he say about himself? He said that he was our God, that he was the Lamb of God who would take away the sins of the world, that he is the resurrection and the life, that he is the bread of life. He is the living water that quenches our thirst. And because God cannot lie, then I know that what the Lord reveals about himself must be true. But you know what else? I now also know that what he reveals about me must be true. I can't even believe things I think about myself at times, right? Some of you maybe have a super sensitive conscience and you're beating yourself down on and on. And others of you, you need to have a better one, all right? But you know, we can't even believe what we think about ourselves at times. I can't believe I did that. I can't believe I went there. You're right? But you see, I can believe what he says about me because he knows me eternally. He knows me thoroughly. He knows every secret thing about me. He knows things about me I haven't even begun to figure out myself. And so what he says about me must be true. And what does he say about me? He says that I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. That doesn't take me any convincing, all right? Some of you it might. But he says, you know what? You need to be saved from your sins. You need to have one who can conquer your sin, your death, and your grave. Not only does he reveal who I truly am before him, the need that I truly have before him, but lastly, he is the one who reveals everything about my future. What does he say about my future? He says, you know what? If you will call upon me to be your Savior, I will in no way cast you aside. John chapter 6. That means it doesn't matter what my background is, what I've done, what I haven't done, etc., etc. Jesus promised me that all who call upon him, he will in no way cast aside. Ah, what else does he promise me about my future? Well, he promises me that he is the resurrection and the life. And even though when I die, he says, you know, you shall live forevermore with me. In fact, he goes on to say in John chapter 14, he said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. If it were not so, I would have told you, he said. Ah. And all of a sudden, when I begin to focus on him and I focus on his resurrection, then all of a sudden, I can develop what I so desperately need, a full assurance of faith. Because you see, we all need an assurance that goes beyond us. I need an assurance that goes beyond my failures. I need an assurance that goes beyond my brokenness. I need an assurance that goes beyond my hurt or my pain or my struggles or whatever else it may be in my life. I need an assurance that is outside of me. But I need an assurance that's outside of my circumstances. I need an assurance that's outside of my world. If I'm going to have full assurance, I need an assurance that comes from God and not from me. Every belief that I have in God, every belief I have in God, his love, his grace, his mercy, his kindness, his faithfulness, his compassions, they are all anchored in the resurrection. And it's got to be your anchor as well. It is the ground of assurance, of faith and of practice. Without it, good luck. Because you and I live in a world of such despair. You and I live in a world of death. Last night, I was on the phone with someone a loved one passed away. Yeah. And at that moment is when we really realize how desperately we need an assurance that goes beyond us. Not in theory, but in the reality of that phone call, in the reality of that circumstance, and in the reality of that moment when death is up close and personal in your life, you know you need an assurance that goes far beyond what is ever innate to you and within your circumstance and within your world. You need an assurance that comes from heaven. The resurrection is God's assurance to us. It is a full assurance of faith. Do I hear an amen to that? Praise God. It is not only the ground of all assurance of faith and practice, it is also the ground of all future hopes for you and for me. Let me ask you today, where's your hope truly anchored? It needs to be completely wedded to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because God reveals to us this uncomfortable truth. There is zero hope apart from the resurrection. There is zero hope for you, for me, for Paul, for Mother Teresa. Apart from the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians where he says, if Christ be not raised from the dead, your faith's worthless. It's not about just having faith. Oh, my faith is sincere. Yeah. If the tomb isn't empty, it's not going to matter. Because no one's conquered the grave. So you see, God says there is zero hope apart from resurrection. And I think God illustrates that in his word, and I want you to get this down. We love the word hope, and we read it so many times in the New Testament, but there's something really interesting that I think God is revealing in that word hope for us. You see, the word hope is used about 80 times in the New Testament. And it's elpis in Greek. I remember that from way back in seminary days because I used to think it's Elvis. You know, so never forgot it. You won't either. And that word, it's fascinating how God uses it. This word that's used over 80 times in the New Testament. But did you know that it is only found two times before the resurrection? One of those is in the prophetic fulfillment of Isaiah that the Messiah would be the hope of the Gentiles. Almost every single occurrence of the word hope is after the resurrection. I think it's clear God is saying something to us that he doesn't want us to ever forget. His remedy to a world in despair, to a heart in despair, to a life in despair is resurrection. It's outside of you, it's outside of me, it's outside of our circumstances, outside of our world. It is encased, embodied, and revealed in resurrection. I love the simplicity of how Paul puts it in 1 Timothy chapter 1 when he's writing to his dear friend and companion, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the commandment of God, our Savior, and of Christ Jesus, who is our hope. Isn't that beautiful? Who is Jesus to you? He's my hope. Why? Because he alone has conquered sin, death, and the grave. Who is Jesus to you? He's my hope. He is God's hope for the despair of my life and of my world. You see, God's plan all along was to give you and me and fallen man a future and a hope. Something we forfeited in our sin and rebellion, but God didn't leave us there, right? He came along. He revealed his plan, and his plan was all about redemption. It was all about saving us from our sins, and therefore, it was all designed to give us a future and a hope. We love to quote Jeremiah 29, verse 11, where God declared, "I know the plans that I have for you. Plans for welfare, not for calamity, to give you a future and a hope." But you know what? We don't often zoom in on what that revelation is. He said, look, here's the plans. It is my plan, God says. My plan all along was to give you a future and to give you a hope. And so, when Paul is addressing both the Sanhedrin in chapter 23 and in chapter 24 before the Roman authorities, what is he doing? He is revealing that hope has come. God's design for you and for me, for our future, has arrived. It is encased and embodied and reflected in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You and I know intuitively that the world is not all there is to us, right? Somehow, deep down inside, we know that one day we are all going to stand before God, the holy, eternal God of this universe. And we are all going to stand before him without any credit cards. We're going to all stand before him without any multi-million dollar record contracts. Sorry, Blake. We're going to all stand before him without any advanced degrees. We're all going to stand before him without any shingles added. In fact, the Bible says we're going to stand naked before him. And what does that simply mean? It means that all the props that we often look to in this world to give us meaning or assessment or value in our life will be gone. We will not stand with one single prop of this world before him. Nothing to rely upon. Nothing to lean upon. We will stand before him with no help from the props of this world. And what every one of us needs, you and me, every one of us needs, we need two things on that day that we stand without one single prop to our name. We're going to need two things. We're going to need a cross and an empty tomb. We are going to need the cross of Jesus to cover our sins. And we're going to need the resurrection of Jesus to conquer our death. Praise the Lord. The full assurance of all our future hopes is in his resurrection. Because Jesus Christ did not simply vacate the tomb on the third day. He conquered it. He didn't merely depart from the tomb, he defeated it. And he didn't merely empty the tomb, he emptied it for you and for me. And so God has done something incredible for us that speaks to the ground of all our future hope. He has stripped us of being able to stand before him with any worldly props so that we can rely upon the one thing heaven will offer us. and that is the great high priest. You see, I don't know about you, I hope so, but I know that when I stand before him, I can stand with full assurance of faith, not because of who I am, God forbid, but because I won't stand alone. Oh yeah, I will stand naked before him, but I won't stand alone. You see, there's an advocate, Jesus Christ the righteous, who sits at the right hand of the Father, who is, as the great high priest does, ever intercedes for his people, carries them on his heart, and he will be the one who will stand for me as my advocate on that day, and with the full assurance that he has paid it all, he has borne the price so that I could be received, so that God's wonderful design of giving me a future and a hope could be mine forever and ever. Hallelujah. What a Savior. Amen. Give the Lord a praise offering this morning. And I hope that you've received him, because you know what? God doesn't want you to stand alone. You don't want to stand alone. And God has provided the eternal advocate, the conqueror of the grave, to stand right there with you. What a good God. You know what? Lastly, not only is it the ground of our faith, the ground of our future hopes, it is also the ground of all the daily power you and I need in a world that too often drags us down in so many incredible ways. You want to know something incredible about the resurrection of Jesus Christ? The power of that resurrection is relentlessly killing sin in heart and life of every born believer. That power, the power of the resurrection, has been relentlessly killing sin in my life since the moment I received him as my Savior as a older teenage young man. And so for at least 20 years, he's been doing what I could never do myself. He's been killing sin in my heart and life. And sometimes I'm frustrated and I wish it were a little quicker. I wish I didn't have to go through this, that, or the other, right? And you probably do the same, right? Hear an amen to that? For you, not just for me, right? We're in this together, okay. But the reality is, the moment we become identified as his child, the power of the resurrection has done something incredible. You see, God has sent us the chain breaker. And it is Jesus Christ who is the glorious and eternal chain breaker. He has broken the chain of death. And we're going to experience that in a most powerful way. But he has also broken the chain of dark. He's broken every chain. There's none that he hasn't conquered when he conquered sin, death, and the grave. And therefore, it is the resurrection that is the basis of what God is doing in your life and in my life. Don't ever forget that. Sometimes we think it's all up to us. And, you know, I just got to gut this out. And I can do this on my own. And we think somehow we're a failure if we don't ask for help, if we don't seek other people to come alongside of us. You know, why aren't I, you know, tough enough? Why can't I manage this? And those are just lies of the enemy trying to obscure the reality that, you know what? Dead people can't leverage their way out of death. Dead people can't leverage their way to life. We need something supernatural to take place in our life. And that's what God has done and wants to display in your life and mine. One last verse in Ephesians 1. I love how Paul says, I pray that you will understand the incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe. This is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead and seated him in the place of honor at God's right hand in the heavenly realm. You know, if God had not revealed this truth to us and I were trying to convince you of it, if I were you, I would be incredibly skeptical. I mean, it is mind-boggling. It is stunning to see what God is revealing here. That the same mighty power that defeated your death, your hell, is at work in you, right? To bring about resurrected living in your life. You and I need to understand as children of God, if you've received the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, you and I need to understand the power of change in our life is in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. God stepped into your death with resurrected power, but it means he's also stepped into your darkness, your scars, your pain. He has stepped into your despair. He has stepped into your struggles. And he has stepped in, how? With the mighty resurrected power, the same power that raised Christ from the dead. When God steps into your life and in my life, he doesn't step in weakly. He doesn't step in cautiously. He steps in with the great, mighty power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and he wants the people of God to know what it is to walk in freedom, amen, to walk in power, to live out in their daily life the resurrected power of Christ. Do we do it perfectly? No. But you know what? God wants to grow you in this area. Let him. Don't resist God's work in this area in your life. Don't hold on to that sin, that issue, that pit, struggle in your life and let it dominate you. It will only be designed to try and drag you down, right? God says, I want you to unleash it to my resurrected power. Just as you know that I am going to raise you from death itself and the judgment of sin, death, and the grave, know that I am going to unleash my resurrected power in you. I will give you victory in that area. And I pray that today you will make a decision to trust him in that area of your life with the same resurrected power, just as you have full assurance that when you die, you will not be defeated. God says, I want you to have that same full assurance right now that that area that's been beating you down for years, I can change. I can set you free. For you see, the resurrection is the great chain breaker over your death, over your darkness, over your despair, over your struggle. And so as the praise team comes this morning, my prayer for every child of God is that this morning you will anew and afresh make a recommitment to the Lord, a recommitment that you will not accept anything less than growing in the resurrected power of the Lord Jesus Christ in your life. God, teach me more what that means, what that looks like for me to be the husband you've called me to be in resurrected power, to be the wife you've called me to be resurrected, to be the parent you've called us to be the worker you've called me to be, to serve you the way you've called me. Show me, Lord God, how you want me to live out your resurrected power. And as we stand to sing, we're going to sing what? We're going to sing of this hope that is transcendent, this hope, if we can get those lights, Judd, a hope that is transcendent, a hope that is victorious, a hope that is conquering, and it's where? It's not in you. It's not in me. It's in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And today, if you've never received that hope, I'm going to invite you, come now, respond to the love of God, which is offered to you, a forgiveness and eternal life in Jesus Christ. Pastor Judd will be at the front here to share with you how you can enter into that relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. You make that decision. You come this morning. Let us sing together.
There is a light, salvation's flame, Christ undefeated, trembled the grave. See now the cross. The light has won, behold the Christ. Hope has a name, his name is Jesus, my Savior's cross has set the sinner free. Hope has a name, his name is Jesus. Oh Christ, be
song, Christ be praised, we have the victory. We thank you that you have given us hope that is sure, steadfast, and anchored to your very eternal holy throne. And his name is Jesus. For that we give you thanks and praise for time and for eternity. And all God's people said, amen, amen. God bless you.